So good morning, everybody. Welcome, everybody. This is a brief session about building a known device at home. So something quite easy to do at home. So something about me. I am an embedded system engineer. I am from Trieste, Italy. I am graduate in telecommunications. I am actually working at Nomovok, Finland, so a Linux embedded solution company. I am a custodian of the ColdFire architecture on U-boot. I give some contribution to Linux kernel also, and for the ColdFire part, and I am member of MITLAB Hackerspace and Linux user group in my hometown. Okay, so the aim of this talk is just to present a possible alternative way to build an embedded device. So instead of buying one, it could be sometime interesting try to build one by your own. So. Of course, it's something not really easy for a first start. So I mean, if there is not high experience on or practice on solderings and things like that, it can be a bit difficult as a first start. So there can be errors, there can be issues, so components to buy and things like that. So a little investment, but there can be some motivations. Of course, one can ask what could be the benefits. So I can buy an embedded board ready. So I try here some answers. So to grow some additional skill on the hardware side, so understanding a bit what's happened as digital signals, interconnections, how peripherals works, and things like that. So then you can select some combination of components that you like to experience. And for example, you can select a CPU and non-volatile memories. So what you want, what you like. You can contribute eventually to some Linux driver development or fixing or adapting something. And of course, finally customizing a bit the board, so adding some components that could be needed. For this session, there is this example board is very limited, is not innovative. I mean, it's not a new technology, but it's simple to understand how the things works for the start. So it is just 100 megahertz, and is a ColdFire CPU without memory management unit. Is with a 4 megabyte parallel NOR flash and 16 megabyte of synchronous dynamic RAM. Okay, some requirements, maybe not few. So. At least some basic electronic knowledge, like just the basics. So some know the difference between AC and DC, ohm law, what are resistor, capacitors, transistors, so diodes, how resistor works, series and parallel things, series and parallel connections, pull-up, pull-down resistors. Things like that. So there are plenty of tutorials, books, or there can be some expert friend to ask. Then some minimal measurement equipment, also here at least a multimeter and an oscilloscope, a solder station with a better a conic, a quite thin tip, so possibly also with a not hair gun, if possible. So in case of errors, you can desolder and remove the components and try to recycle them. So, and other small things, are solder paste, tin, some alcohol, lens. Lens is very important because it can help a lot, even when the sight is not perfect. So with a good lens or some visual instrument, you can see much better. Okay, some practice that can be done, for example, with old boards, so dyed board, removing components and try to resolder them or things like that. Okay, it's not necessary, of course, a whole laboratory or this is something in my house done in some years, but of course, initially it's good only just a table that can be used to practice so that you can damage it. So, in case you want to spend some money, of course, the most used instrument for these things is the oscilloscope, and it is very, it can really fast up the job. Of course, it can cost also a lot. This one is mine, is the cost about of a laptop, I mean, not that much, but also not few money. So it's a good candidate to spend money in, because it can really fast up the job. And in case, I suggest at least 1 megapoint of memory, so you can capture a big time frame, and you can zoom, and it very fast up the things. So the CPU selections is quite exciting. So you can select some CPU in the Linux from the Linux architecture folder. Of course, here there are some limitations. You cannot select a CPU or a system on chip too complex. I mean, there are a CPU with too high cost to perform this kind of things at home. So and also too complex, so there are of course some limitations, but I can suggest some QFP package, so it's easy to solder, and generally it is a 0.5 millimeter pitch, so yes, it's quite easy to solder, so with some practice. There are several chances, so from this cold fire selected from the CPU that is just 100 megahertz, to some other that has 1 gigahertz, or finally you can find something also with 10 megabyte of internal static RAM. So you can try to have Linux working without an external dynamic RAM, so for example. Okay, clock frequency is a key point. I mean, you can do something at home with not. It is suggested to start with not too high bus frequency, otherwise things get complicated, of course, for signal timing issues. So high speed signals has some complexity. So, and a look on the price can be useful. So sometimes you can find some components, some samples, maybe for free or at a good price. So also it's very important if there are development boards, documentation, schematics, application notes and things like that can help a lot. So a first choice after the CPU is the non-volatile memory. Of course here you need a non-volatile memory, of course, generally to boot a first binary, so generally a bootloader, for example, and it must be loaded into RAM. So the initial ROM loader can execute directly sometime with executing in place with some parallel flash, or there are of course plenty of boot method offered from the CPU, depending from the CPU you select, of course. Here you can check the boot types from the very first type, so you can select a CPU with the boot type you prefer. Of course, more are the boot types, this means that the CPU is more recent, so it can be more complex to have it working. So SPI NOR are in generally in packages like TSOP, easy to solder. NAND flash chips are also available in TSOP, but of course they introduce some error check issues, so can be this can increase complexity. But a good way to start could be a parallel NOR, for example, as in this sample board. Okay, so I can jump a bit over. This is a simple parallel NOR flash. So you have, I colored in different color the pinout, so there is the address bus. It's very simple, and the data bus, so the DQ pin, and some control pin, just the chip enable, output enable, and write enable. So it's very easy to understand for to start. It can be read randomly. Of course, to write it, you need the standard sequences. So it's a bit slow the process, but it is good to start. So this is just an example how it works. You set an address on the address bus from the CPU side, then you put down the chip enable, you put down the output enable, always with the address value set, and after some time the flash gives out the value on the data bus, and you can check here also the wait state. So sometimes the CPU is too fast to read this data, so it has generally configurable wait states inside some register, so you can wait a bit more before reading the data. Okay. This is a 16-bit flash, so it is readable in 16-bit words. Okay, also as non-BGA package, you can find some parallel flash, some greater parallel flash. So I have seen until 1 gigabit, but there can be, of course, greater. Now, I didn't very big research, but so the size is generally in bit, so you have to convert it in bytes. So it's 256 megabyte. Okay, so this parallel NOR are erased in blocks. Can be read randomly, very simple way. The throughput is known to be not that high. Of course, a whole cycle can require 100 nanoseconds, something like that. And you can fast up with some tricks like burst read, page read, and the like. So then, depending on the CPU, that's the RAM. You can select a SDRAM and, of course, also a DDR, but things get much more complex. And in this sample board, has been selected a synchronous dynamic RAM, so just the first generation. So it's a 16 megabyte SDRAM. So dynamic RAM are just formed from of course, capacitors and transistor cells. Refreshes generally handled from the CPU. So understanding how column and row addressing works can be a bit complex. But fortunately, generally, CPU data sheets give some tables for each kind of memory that you want to connect. There are generally some tables that tell you how to connect, how to wire the connections. So then about customization, you decide, of course, the time is limited, so I couldn't dedicate too much time to the customization because I thought that is more important, the main part of the board is understood, but I try to add here something. So you can add this board, this simple board just add some an Ethernet chip, So it's a full Ethernet chip with the Mac and the physical part, and it is connected in a parallel bus, so in a simple fashion also. Then I have here, it's connected an I2C RTC chip, and then I left a generic connector where I brought the address bus, data bus, and GPIOs. So in any case, you can extend later the board with a connector, so with some functionality later. Okay, then of course, related to the CPU that you select, you can add several devices around. So you can add all the kind of Wi-Fi modules or connected through UART or SDIO or whatever interface available on the CPU, of course. Okay, then this is a development approach, of course, not maybe the best one, but just one. So you select a CAD software. You start with the schematic diagram. You complete it. And there is, of course, the practice of checking for errors. Then you move to the PCB side. You route all the connections. Also on the PCB side, you perform all the electrical checks. And then you can proceed to the manufacturing part, so generating some Gerber files and look for the best price and quality compromise from the very huge number of PCB producers. So nowadays, until some years ago, the multi-layer PCB, like in this board that is 4-layer, was quite expensive. But nowadays, you can find good prices. It's very the price is really decreased a lot, so it's now possible to spend much less and perform also some more versions. So if you do some error, you can reorder some other batch. So for example, three prototypes can be, you can pay $100, but also much less if you want, if you can wait much more time. So the price is sometimes connected to the delivery time. So then, of course, the PCB is something that cannot be done at this level at home, because if you want a board that is some way small, you cannot, it's difficult to think to do the PCB at home. Of course, someone did some double face, is available on the net, but the board is much more greater and of course can be unwanted. So, okay, so then the last steps are just waiting the PCB and solder the components and debug for errors step by step. Okay, in case you find issues on the PCB, you can do some temporary hack, of course, with cutting tracks or using wires. It's not necessary to order immediately another one, so you can still stay with the board with some minimal fixes. So, didn't jump anything? Okay. Then, okay, about the CAD, there are several and several chances. There are several possibilities. So KiCad is the one I used. It's open source. It's free. It's you can have several tutorials and support. I think all of you know it. So then there are non-free, so cheap but closed. Still very good CAD, but of course you should pay something, or you have some free version with the limited size of the board. Then there are several others. Of course, there are very, very expensive CAD that can do several magic things, as you know. And they are not in the purpose of this session. So CAD is just a tool, and of course, with a good experience, you can improve the design and have a good result even with a cheap CAD or a free CAD. So a way to start is from the power supply. So if you select a simple CPU like this, there is just one power supply, 3.3 volt. So it's very simple in this case, of course. As much the CPU complexity grow, as much the power supply stage is start to be very complex. You could also need some power management EC or the like, but of course is not a thing that I consider to do, that can be done at home, but of course, as much simpler is the CPU, simpler will generally be the power supply stage. So nowadays, you can select a buck converter, for example. So you can check the data sheet. So is some time important, depending from the IC, the drop between the input voltage and the output voltage. So you have to select the power stage, considering, of course, the total current that should be consumed from the board and overestimated. So, of course, some more. You don't have, at home, you don't have price limit, so you can select an IC, a power stage much more powerful than the need. So sometime if this IC should give out 2 ampere, is not always true. Depends from also could depend from this drop. So if the drop between input output voltage is very low, it can give the maximum current. Otherwise, if instead 5 volt in the input side, you put 12 volt, the current it can give could be less, of course. So these power supplies, of course, give out just the current the asked from the load. So they are the less generation, of course. Nothing is, you can still use the old linear one, so it's not something important, too much important. So then you have to select some filtering capacitors. Of course, you can check the equivalent serial resistor. So if it's very low value, you can have generally a better clean DC as in output filtered. So then you can put some LED just to check if the power is there. So once the power is done, you just connect on the CPU all the ground connections and all the VCC connections. For this CPU is quite simple because there is only one power supply domain. So then you connect the oscillator, so the parts around the CPU. Oscillator, so some bootstrap options. Generally, CPUs has some initial configuration that you have to set time to ground or to CC some pins, so things like bus speed or initial configuration. So then also here sometime one can say, okay, so you have to check the data sheet to check everything around the CPU, how must be configured. But if you don't want to spend the life some time to read thousands of pages of a datasheet, you can look, of course, development boards and understanding what should be connected, or similar boards, of course. Then connection of the non-volatile memory. In this case, it's a parallel bus, so it's very simple. So you just connect the address bus and the data bus for this CPU. Okay, about the address bus, this flash is only readable at 16-bit word, so you have just to connect address 1 of the CPU to the address 0 of the flash. This is because you can only read 16-bit words. And on the data side, this is a big endian CPU, so I connected here just the most significant bytes. The 2 most significant bytes on the data bus. Then there are just some other connections, so the chip select, output enable, write enable that goes, this signal goes directly to the CPU, so it's quite easy to connect. And okay, then there is the SDRAM connection. Here also there are, it can be difficult, but you can look to the development boards. In most of the cases, also embedded boards uses, they use a very similar or equal connection of dynamic RAM of the development board. So this is a good way to start, I think. Different configurations, if you select a different exotic configuration for your board, start some job behind this, because you cannot anymore use some ready-made parts, so some parts of the software like U-boot has, and to configure the RAM. So you have to start to adjust these configurations, and there is some more job behind. So it can still be done, but of course requires some more experience. So customizing, then this board just connects an Ethernet chip mainly. You can select what you like, so it depends from the interfaces available on the CPU. So you can select SPI, I2C, or SDIO devices, or whatever, so codecs, so I2S, or things like that. So you follow application notes generally, so there are always, from the component you select, there are always some application notes, so an additional datasheet with circuits and sample circuits, so you can follow partially, of course, them, because they generally use some, they can be generic, or they use other host CPUs or the like. So customization can still be done in a further step if you add some connectors. So if you want to add some sensors or something else, you can keep some general connectors, so you don't need to fix the hardware to a specific configuration. Still, this board has some UART ports for debug or other purposes, and a simple RTC chip, so with a cell battery and an additional clock quartz. So, okay, then finally you complete the electrical error check. So, of course, the CAD tell you if there are some unconnected wires or something wrong, so if you duplicated something or some connection is open, things like that. Then you have to assign, of course, the modules to the components. So in the schematics, you just, of course, select the components, but not the package. So you will need to associate to select what package for each component you want. So this is a middle step before passing to the PCB side. Then the PCB design, of course, it's not mandatory to be a professional designer, to have some simple Linux board working. So with some attentions, avoiding initially some high bus frequencies, so a basic board should work. There are several good tutorials around. I'm not talking just a bit on how to design the PCB, but I don't want to enter this field because it's very, very huge of theory and difficult. There are also black magic inside. So I'm not going to enter on this too much, but just a bit. So just to give some guidelines. So before you start, you should focus. Even later, but you can start to check a PCB manufacturer, so the prices, because each manufacturer has some constraints, so they give you the size of the vias of the tracks, the minimal track size, the minimal via drill, and things like that. So of course, before proceeding with the PCB design, you need to know these constraints, these limits. Then you can, of course, insert the data of the of your board in some website, and they give as an output several choices of constructors and prices, so and time delivery. So you can select between many chances. So this sample board uses this parameter, so maybe they can be useful. Okay, just some hints. So I used a four-layer strategy because I would like not a too much big board, so quite small board. So I selected a four-layer. I selected to go for a four-layer PCB. Of course, you can decide for a different strategy. It's just a matter also of money and, of course, how much you want to spend to have the PCB. So just one scheme I used, one strategy I used is to use four layers, so with a top layer with UCC and the ground on the bottom layer and the two signals layers in the middle. Of course, an expert designer can say this is not the best solution. Some constructors suggest six layers. Of course, there is much theory behind, so you should keep the signal layers always next to a ground plane. This for impedance, return paths, and things like that. But in any case, this first attempts I did worked. Resistors. You generally resistor and the common 100 nanofarad capacitors. You can select hand soldering pads, so a bit wider pads, so they can help the soldering. And capacitors, of course, bypass capacitors need to be always physically near the IC because they have to filter noises and high frequency signals to ground. And also, of course, a changing of supply stage. So if an IC is in idle state, then change to active state, there can be some power variations. So these capacitors are able to help to compensate these jumps. So they need to be near the IC. And okay, oscillator is not that critical. I mean, most of the cases it still works even if you don't put too much care, too much attention on the oscillator part. But there are some good rules. So generally, you can also find on the datasheet sometime the PCB layout of the oscillator. So keeping the tracks of the same length and ground around, things like that, of course, helps. Okay, this is just the buck converter part. Here also, you can use, for example, a USB micro connector, so you don't need to add additional components for an erroneous power inversion. So there cannot be any power inversion, so you don't need any MOSFET or diode in serie or things like that. And just to keep it simple, so you can just use a fuse or something like that to limit the maximum current. So a good grounding also help in this kind of buck converters because they need to drain the heat through the ground layer. So they are quite hot if they are giving out near the maximum current. So they need to, of course, release this heat. So correct width, of course, the tracks need to keep to have the current width for the current they should keep. So of course, you have to do some approximate calculations of the current that need to pass on a track, and of course you can stay much higher as a width, so you don't have any issues. then there is much more knowledge to improve in case. So these are just simple hints. So the SDRAM is the most difficult part, because if it's not working, if it's not routed correctly, things can go bad. So the board can have issues, so nothing works. There can be the need of terminator resistors. So this is a quite critical step. So there are generally two kind of issues. So long tracks reflection or short lines rings. So there is a huge theory behind this. I prefer to avoid to enter inside this, but try to give some pragmatic hints. So there are also some very interesting books about this. So checking development boards generally help, because those board works. So at least you know that if those board have serious terminator resistors, so so this means you can replicate that configuration, and you know it is working. If we consider only the short line ring, so we keep the SDRAM near the CPU, some series resistors could be needed, of course. You can set up the PCB for them, and then in case you can short and not use them or do some tests. So we will see later. So DDR memories, the things are a bit different and more complex, of course. I am doing some tests here in this board, but there are some other power supply involved, and there some different termination can be used. So still in the SDRAM, this can work sometime even without any termination resistor. This is how I did it the first time. There are some rings, but the signal levels are still detected properly on the receiver side. So high and low level are still detected properly. So also because the bus clock is 15 megahertz, so there are not much issues still. There are some academic rules, of course, some equations to know the value of this terminator resistor. Of course, this is just a configuration of termination. There are several. The serious termination is generally one of the most used and simple, because you can use just a single resistor. And mainly, the output impedance of the driving stage must match the impedance of the line. So since the output stage is a CMOS stage generally, so the output impedance is very near to zero, so should be zero ideally, but it's very near. So you should add often a resistor to match the line impedance. So it is generally 22 ohm, but it can vary, of course. For the serial resistor is only a compromise, because also the output impedance of the driving stage has a different value between high stage, high level, and low level. So you need to find a compromise. A pragmatic way could be to use a potentiometer in serie, and of course you can find the perfect value to avoid the rings. So there is much more theory. I don't want to enter because it's too wide. So at the end, once you routed in the best possible way the dynamic RAM, you can also launch the auto routing, because you can reduce quite a lot you can reduce development time. So you can even launch it over the night, and in the morning you will find that some connection was not was unresolved. So here the human ability can find a way to close these 10, 20 connection, whatever they are left out. So then here start the practice part. So You can start, for example, from the power supply. So you can just solder all the power supply components, and then you check by scope, by oscilloscope, the output voltage. So you can see if the level is correct, and if there are noises, if there are some garbage over the DC voltage. So sometimes it's not so critical. So sometimes it can even work if it's not a perfect power supply stage. So here, of course, the low ESR capacitors helps a lot. And also some bypass capacitors to drain to ground some noises is always inserted in power supply stages. So once the power supply is working, you know it is giving out the correct voltage. If you have issues, you can still check sample circuits in the datasheet. So this is the CPU. You can put it. Okay, of course, I forgot to add here that the board should be handled carefully. So a bit in the border. So try to avoid to put the fingers on the devices because they are CMOS, generally CMOS, and they are sensitive to electrostatic discharges. But I never broken one. I mean, so just some careful handling is can help. So you put careful the CPU initially, and you have to center it. Of course, here lens help a lot. Some also cheap lens of a few dollars is okay, a few euros. So once the CPU is well centered, you can just fix a corner with something. So just a minimal soldering, better just one pin. So in case you can still adjust it so easily, or one or two pins. So it's not important. And then you can proceed side by side soldering all the pins. This is an operation to be done very carefully, so with a very careful hand. I mean, not pressing, not doing any operation that can damage the pins, because they are very very easy. They can easily be bent. So. You have to be careful and mainly drag on the right and outside. So you can transport some tin, and when it is too much, you can drag it out some way with some movements outside. So here the solder paste helps a lot, because you have to test some solder paste. You can find one that produces very, very bright, shiny solderings, so it's very good, because a good solder paste helps, of course, the tin to move away from, to slide away from shorts. So as much as is wet and shiny, as much easier are the things generally. So you can use a lot of solder paste, and then you can remove from the tip the solder that the tin that is exceeding, so in excess. So you can remove it from the tip, and you proceed better, because you avoid shorts. So if solderings are not brilliant, are not shiny, you can test a different solder paste. Then, once the CPU is soldered, you can verify by a lens, by a cheap lens, nothing special, and you should be able to see all the solderings, if they are well soldered, and also if they are not soldered. So generally, you are able to see by eye these unsoldered or shorts, of course, are generally visible, shorts and open circuits. So a very careful check all around in all four corners generally give you a good information of the possibility that the component works at the first power connection. So then you need to solder, of course, the components around. So compared to CPU, resistors and things like that are really easy. So you just need some tweezers, some tools to keep it. You just put some tin on one pad, then you block the components and you solder the other pad. It's not that difficult. Then you need to solder the debug interface connector, and you can power up and check what is happening. So if the 3.3, if the power supplies are still there, so you probably did a good job. Mainly there are no shortcuts to ground. So otherwise the voltage can drop down, can sit down. So if the voltage is still there, this is a good point. Otherwise, disconnect immediately, of course, the power supply and check for errors. The soldering shape should be like in this picture, and at least I find quite easy to solder these three dimensions of resistor and capacitors. Okay, of course, if the soldering is a bit rounded, it's still good, but it is important it's not a ball. I mean, it must be something more is still good, but you have to check careful sometime by lens if you are not sure, but generally you can reach a good soldering without too many issues. So here is the flash, same method. So you position it, you just fix it on a corner, and then you solder it. You solder it side by side. A final lens check is of course needed, so you can check if there are shorts or open solderings, and then. Some good cleaning with a toothbrush or similar tool and alcohol can give you a very clean and nice result at the end. So you can power up and still check if there is the power supply or if there is something strange. Of course, if the components if there is some shortcuts, in most of the cases, the component is not damaged because the short never damage what is on the valley side, but it keep very hot the other side, so the power supply. So a small tip is if there is too much tin on the pads, so shorts and things like that, you can give some small shots, just only blocking with the whistle on the table, or some small shots on the table. You just hit the tin, and immediately after you give some small shots, and the excess tin run away generally. Then of course here also there is a lens check, and. You can quite often see if everything is good. Here also the same for the synchronous dynamic RAM, same process. So the pitch is always 0.5 millimeter, so it's not that dramatic to solder it. So fix a corner and then solder side by side very carefully. Of course, you can do some mistake. Oh, the time is finished. So, okay, I go very fast to the end. If you do some mistake, of course, you can try to solve by a needle and some tool, and to have the pin not banded anymore. So then some preliminary checks. So you can do some pin-to-pin continuity test to see if, for example, the continuity between CPU and flash is okay. You can check between pin and pin, so you have the full path tested for the continuity. And then you check the clock is running. So then some checks for the parallel null flash. Okay, you can create, once the CPU is running, you create a small binary tool. These are most software things, so you use some common sequences to program the flash. These are common write sequences, and you can have some small, you can write some small algorithm to test, to write and read data and test if the value read are okay, or from there you can see if there is some unconnected pin or some shortcuts. So here then the SDRAM init is very important because you will use it to flash, to write the program on the flash. And after the initialization, the SDRAM should work. So also here you have to, you can write some pattern on the RAM, some simple test routine to test the whole address range and see if it is working. And of course, you can do some of these checks also through the debugger, so you don't need to upload a binary on the internal static RAM. But of course, I prefer that tool, so it's more manageable for me. Okay, the rest is software. So here is the bootloader. It is the flash has been partitioned with three partitions. So in the first partition there is U-boot. Then there is the kernel with the ROMFS, and that's all. So this is the kernel booting, and I can show some very brief live demo of the board. And here we are. So that's all from my side. So if you have questions. Yes?
Which software did you use to design the PCB?
Okay, I used KiCad, that is an open source. Yeah. Open source tool is very friendly. I find it friendly, and there is also an IRC channel, so there are guys that very friendly can help you in the usage, and that is full of tutorial and video and things like that help you to start. So I used KiCad for this four-layer board is still good. So other questions? Yes? Yes.
So only just some parts on a PCB from the parallel layers tests in the policy.
Okay. I didn't use any test point because I have a good practice with the probes, and I can measure, of course, on the pin of the devices. In this case, are all QFP packages, so you can measure on the pin. Of course, test points are a good thing because measuring, sometimes you can do some short, so some bad operation, you can also do some damage. So test points are always better than measuring on the pin. But of course, yes, they must be taught before, so at the PCB design level. So also maybe at the schematic level you can add them. So I don't remember now, but I generally don't use them, but it's a good practice, of course. Yes? Okay, I am not, I don't have much experience on manufacturers. I mean, Sometimes there can be some manufacturers that offers also some PCB producer that offers also manufacturing.
Yeah, because for example, the connection of the connectors and so on, that's not difficult, but for example, soldering a big SMD, like the microchip.
Yes. You can look around also in your hometown, near my town, or also in my town, there are some manufacturer that can also produce some very small batches. So you can go there with the board components, and in some days, of course, when they have the right moment to put the things on machines, they can do it. So you can find them quite easily, of course. I generally prefer to do this at home because I like to solder, so it's just a matter of... there can be some more difficult components to solder. And now I am soldering some VGA, so I am succeeding. And of course, it's money consuming because you can do some errors. So, but with some entry-level soldering stations, 200 euro, things like that, 300 euro, you can start to solder VGA. Someone solder them with hot air. There are various methods, so you can pre-solder the pads, but keeping very flat, or you can not pre-solder the pads, just solder the BGA by hot air. I have several feedbacks that the method works often. Of course, in not very big BGA, but like this is 256 balls, so still can work. Okay. Finish. Thank you.